don't think I sang one.
All right. Okay. So here we go. I've placed the link to the Google form in the chat. I'll send it again at the end of the workshop just to make sure everybody gets it in case we got some people who joined late or anything like that. But good afternoon, everyone. My name is Jonathan Brooks. I'm going to be the facilitator or host for this workshop on Zoom. We've been doing these Zoom workshops for a couple weeks now, though everything's kind of changing just a little bit every time we do it to adjust for all the things that Zoom's doing to try to protect the faculty from Zoom bombings and things like that. So just to give you a quick overhead, things we're going to talk about today is we're going to activate your account through CSUSB, your Zoom account. We're going to talk about how to schedule a meeting in the Zoom webpage. We're also going to talk about how to schedule a meeting from Blackboard directly and the differences, pros and cons to both of those situations. And then we'll go over some of the in-meeting details while we're going through the settings for creating the meeting as well as the in-meeting options. We're going to look at it from a perspective of how can you use this either setting or feature to engage your students, interact with them, or in some cases secure your room to prevent what's been happening is called Zoom bombings, where people jump into your room, share things that are inappropriate for what you're trying to do. So we're going to talk about all that in hopefully an hour. I'm going to try my best, but we'll see how that goes. All right, let's get started then. I should already be sharing my screen. So what you guys are looking at right now is that Google form. Again, I'll probably send a link towards the end if you didn't have a chance, not a big deal. The first thing that we need to do, everybody in CSUSB has a Zoom account. Whether you're student, faculty, or staff, everybody has an account. However, that account is not necessarily active. The account is not necessarily live unless you go and activate the account. And the easiest way to do that is just go to the CSUSB main page, log into your MyCoyote, find the Collaborate tab, and then click on Zoom. And this is just going to be what I would say is the easiest way to get back to the Zoom webpage in general. If you try to log in directly to Zoom by like typing in their webpage, you're going to run into some issues where you're not logged in through CSUSB or something like that. So I would just recommend, as far as accessing the Zoom webpage, getting logged in, doing it through your MyCoyote portal is probably the safest way to get that done. So we're going to click on Zoom. And if you're taken to this profile page, where hopefully you can see your sign-in email is a CSUSB email, and that this linked account would say single sign-on. If you see those two things, we're generally doing pretty good. And that means that you're linked up and you're ready to go. So the profile page, there's a lot of information on it, but I don't want to spend a tremendous amount of time on here. The big thing is that we do see our CSUSB is linked and that we see the single sign-on, indicating that our MyCoyotes are connected. Up here too, you may see things like CSUSB or something like that. Essentially, you just want to make sure this is your CSUSB account, because if you have it through other accounts, maybe other campuses, or your own personal account that you maybe had set up or were paying for or whatever, it's a possibility that when you click on this, it's going to auto log you in. And if that happens, you're going to need to come up to this profile icon in the top right, sign yourself out, and then go through that process again, starting with your MyCoyote, going to Collaborate and clicking on Zoom, right? So it's just really important that when you get to this page that we see something indicating that this is a CSUSB account and not some other account that you may have already set up. All right. With that, let's jump into the important tab, the meetings tab. This meetings tab is where you're going to have all of the meetings that you currently have upcoming under this first one. The next tab shows you any meetings you've had previously, right? So you can see the meetings that I've been having with different faculty this week. You also have the option for your personal meeting room. And just very quickly, what the personal meeting room is a Zoom room that you have access to simply by the nature of you having a Zoom account. So everyone who has a Zoom account gets access to their own personal meeting room. It's a meeting room that you have all the time, always open to you. You don't have to schedule it. At any point, you can jump in and start using it. You have the option to set the meeting ID. So the way Zoom works is it gives every Zoom room a 9 or 10 digit code, a number. And that code or that number represents the location, essentially, of the Zoom room. And so each one has to be unique, otherwise you're gonna end up in the same spot. Think of this meeting ID as like a physical classroom location, right? So my office would be like PL003. The more you use that same location, the more people have access to that room. So I generally like to reserve my personal meeting room for kind of impromptu, more spontaneous meetings with faculty or my colleagues. If we're working through the email or maybe on the phone and we just can't figure something out, we want the share screen process, I'll use my personal meeting room for that. If I have time to schedule a meeting, I'm probably not going to use my personal meeting ID. But we'll talk about that when we get into the meeting scheduling, which is what we're going to jump into right now. So from the upcoming meetings page, we have a button here that says schedule a new meeting. And if we click on that button, we'll be taken into all the steps to how to schedule a meeting, a Zoom meeting, through the Zoom webpage. Now remember, there's two different things that we're going to do here, right? One's the Zoom webpage and one is through Blackboard. The way I would distinguish the two is I would recommend using the Blackboard tool link that we're going to use for your large classroom gatherings, for your meetings with your students. And there's a few reasons why. The Blackboard one is going to have a little bit more security. It's only going to allow in people who are on your Blackboard roster, right? So you don't have to worry as much about the intrusions or things like that, because the membership of that Zoom meeting should be restricted to the membership of your Blackboard roster. The second reason is it's always going to bring you in as the host automatically without you having to sign in. So you get to access it from Blackboard and you get to be brought in as the host. Again, both of these things are things that we want to also have happen in our webinars, but we have to do a few more things to make that. It doesn't happen as automatically as it does with Blackboard. And if we're comparing the two, I think it's much more valuable that you have complete control all the time without fail over the room where all of your students are going to be. And for your virtual office hours, while we may have to deal with some lesson security features, there are things that we can do to tighten those up a little bit, and we'll go through them now. But again, so main classroom meeting with all your students, we'll save that one for the tool link in Blackboard. But for something like virtual office hours, we can set that up through the Zoom webpage, and that's what we'll do right now. Virtual office hours. With the topic, description, and time and duration, all of this information is purely that. It's information, and that's all it is. And a lot of times, the way we're going to do invitations and things, your students may not even see this information, right? So if we're linking this in your Blackboard or providing a join URL via email or an announcement, the students aren't going to see the actual Zoom invitation, so they're not going to see any of this information. However, it's still important that you put something in there that makes it easy for you to identify. That way, when you get back to this My Meetings page, you don't have five or six meetings that all say My Meeting going to a different place and you have no idea what each one of them is for, right? So even though it's primarily for your information, it's still important that we identify them and mark them and label them that something that makes sense to us. All right, duration. The only thing I'd like to point out about the time and the duration is that unlike other video conferencing softwares that we've tried in the past, Zoom is not restrictive by whatever you put on this field. An example of that is this particular webinar was scheduled to take place at 4 p.m. However, if I wanted to open it up at noon or 2 p.m., I had the availability to do that. It's only scheduled for an hour. However, I can run it for 2 hours, 3 hours, 4 hours if I wanted to, right? Whatever we put in there is the time. It doesn't mean that I have to fit within those time frames, right? And some of the other softwares we worked with have done that. So again, don't feel like whatever you put in here, if you put something in for Monday and then you tried to open it up on Tuesday, it will still open. The room will still exist. Obviously within reason, if we put something in here for 2 months ago, at some point it is going to fall off of our My Meetings tab in the previous meetings. But as you can see, if I go to my next page, I have stuff all the way back from March 11th. So it's almost a month ago and I still have access to that meeting. If I wanted to click on here, I could open that one right back up. I wouldn't rely on that, right? So if you know you want to keep a meeting for a long time, don't just assume that it's going to stick around. What I would do is utilize the recurring meeting feature. And this is what I do with almost all of my meetings, especially if I know I'm going to be using them repeatedly throughout a quarter, for example, like virtual office hours in spring 2020. We make it recurring. And then at that point, you can do one of two things. You can, if you would like, set it up to where it's Monday, Wednesday, Friday, and you set specific dates and times. Again, remember, this is all information, right? So even if you decided to do it on a different date, we have it set up for Monday, Wednesday, Friday, we can still open this on Thursday, right? So for that reason, and because it's not restrictive, I don't like doing it this way, because what happens when you do it this way is you can see right now, we have 19 occurrences of this meeting. What that is going to mean is when I come back to this My Meetings page, I'm going to have 19 links for that same one meeting. All 19 links are going to go to the same exact spot and do the same exact thing. So why do I need 19 of them? I don't think you do. And I think it makes it really hard to navigate your meetings page and find the meetings that you want quickly and conveniently. So instead of doing it this way, where I'm laying out each and every date and time, I kind of take the lazy way out and I just tell Zoom no fixed time, right? So changing my reoccurring meeting, still having it reoccurring, but changing it to no fixed time. And what this tells Zoom is that I want access to this meeting for as long as I want to have access to it. And when I'm done, I will delete it. But until then, it remains on my meetings tab and I remain in control with ability to access that meeting. So all of these meetings that you see here on mine are exactly that. They're meetings that I use. At one point I was using them, you know, once or twice a week, every single week. And I didn't want to create a new meeting and send out a new link to the participants and just have one spot that we meet every single time, much like what we're going to do for you guys with your classrooms, right? One spot where your students can come every single time you guys meet. You don't have to worry about sending out, you know, here's the new link for this week or anything crazy like that. Just a single click and they'll be it. All right. So that's the recurring meeting, no fixed time. Just make sure you keep access to it and it stays on your page. Meeting ID, I would highly recommend you generate this automatically. There's a few reasons for that. One of which we kind of already talked about. If you continue to use the same personal meeting ID for numerous different meeting occasions, more people get access to that room. The more people have access to that room, the more people can get in there, or the more people can distribute that access, right? So talking about Zoom bombings and intrusions and things like that, it's a little bit safer to generate a new one because then that meeting is unique. Now, it doesn't mean that they can't share that out once they get their hands on it, but it is a unique meeting. And so it will be a little bit more secure than a meeting. Like for me, you know, there's quite a few people on campus who have access to my personal meeting room just from faculty consultations and stuff like that. I highly recommend just generate it automatically, a little bit safer. Require a meeting password. This is also a really good security technique, right? We talked about how with the tool link in Blackboard, the membership is restricted to only people who are enrolled in your course. However, that's not the case with any other link that we set up, like this virtual office hours that we're setting up. Or perhaps if something happens with the tool link and we need to recreate it, Harold, you know, in the instance with you, or maybe we would want to use the web link because we need to get people from SSD or other campus entities into the class, and rather than deal with the enrollments issues, we want to do a web link. There might be a couple reasons why we would want to use this instead of the tool link. And if we do, this password is a great way to try to secure it and make it a little safer from those Zoom bombings. By default, these kind of web link join features is just anybody can join within the parameters of the settings that we set up, but we can't limit membership to like only our school or only our students. However, by using the password, you kind of can, right? Because you can just provide the password to your students. And now, even if some random Zoom bomber is getting lucky and just randomly typing in numbers and happens to hit yours, well, now they have to not only get lucky in the random guess and hit yours, they have to also know your password, right? And it's just added one more layer of security. The caution, the caveat that I will say to this is, it does add another layer for your students to get through, right? So it's really important that when we're using these passwords, and it doesn't have to just be numbers, you can type in letters in there too. The one thing I would say is, again, this is all, yes, this is a security feature. However, it does also put another barrier in for our students have to fulfill and complete before they can get in. And I would highly recommend that whatever you put here, you copy it directly and give it to the students, right? Because if there is a difference in a capital letter, for example, in this, what you see on the screen here, if they type spring 2020 with a lowercase s, they will not be allowed into this room, right? So it needs to be exact. Case sensitive, space sensitive, whatever it takes, copy this directly and give it to your students. But it's a really great feature in order to try to avoid some of these Zoom bombings. The other thing that I will say is if you retroactively go back to add this password, right? So say we've created a few meetings, and we want to retroactively go back and add a password after seeing this workshop or whatever. When you add a password, you will have to resend the join link. Adding a password changes the join URL, right? So the join URL is no longer the simple, I think this one would have it, right? The simple CSUSB, Zoom US, and then the numbers. When you add a password to the meeting, it changes the join URL, and I think I have a password on this one, to a much longer join URL, which is fine, it's not an issue, but it does change it. So that old link is not gonna work. So if we're retroactively adding a password, you have to update and send out, you know, that new link so that your students can join or update it on the Blackboard page or whatever that entails. All right, let me just scroll back down to where we were. We did require a meeting password. No, you don't have to send out the link and the password each time. You only have to send out once unless you were changing the password each time, right? So if you're changing the password every week, then yeah, you got to resend that link every time. If you're not and you're keeping it just the same password, then the first time it'll go out, you're good and you can use that one whenever, whether it's Monday, Tuesday, whatever day it is. Awesome. All right. Very quickly here, because I'm a little behind, but not a lot. We're doing okay. Video off, says off. What this is asking is, what is the status of these roles, either host or participant? What is the status of the video when they enter the room? Right. So this isn't saying you can't use video. If this is set to off, it's not saying we're not going to have any video in our meeting. What it's saying is that when you first enter, when you first click on that Zoom link, you'll be brought in with your video either on or off. And I recommend off just because a lot of the times people click on a Zoom just to get in and make sure it works, make sure it's functioning, right? It's new tech for a lot of people. So there's that testing period. And oftentimes they're not ready to be on camera. And so you can run into some embarrassing moments where you catch somebody in a bathrobe or something like that. In order to avoid that, having it set to off just makes things a lot easier. Let them turn their camera on when they're ready to be on camera. Just save yourself some embarrassing moments that way. Audio, both. Allow both people in, or allow more people in. I would say a vast majority of people are going to join via computer audio, which means they have a phone or a tablet or a laptop or a PC or, you know, one of those other options. However, if something happens where maybe they're joining in using their PC, but the microphone on the webcam is broken, they're going to need to dial in. We want to allow that, right? We don't want to restrict how people can access these rooms. I think we're going to have some issues with that just in general. So open it up, be a little more inclusive and allow everybody to get in no matter how they need to connect. Enable join before host. If anybody's been watching any of my previous workshops where I've done this, a lot of these settings are going to change. A lot of my suggestions for these settings need to change in light of these new Zoom bombings and the potential threats that they cause, right? The first workshops were kind of done from a convenience standpoint of everybody's going to be panicked. Everyone's going to be stressed in this transition. How do we get your students and you set up as easy as possible and in the room as quickly as possible? However, a lot of those settings didn't keep in mind how to keep other people out who may have malicious intentions for your room, right? So we're going to have to, I've been slowly kind of changing and reshaping my suggestions. And this is kind of where we're going to see some of those deviations, I guess. And one of them is with enable join before host. It used to be that I would suggest this option. I think it gave a great opportunity for your students to get in, start communicating with their peers, and really just get that confirmation that, okay, we figured the tech out. However, in light of the Zoom intrusions and all of the new security risks, I do not suggest this option. The main problem I have with this now is it allows for the opportunity for one of these Zoom intrusion people to be in a space in a meeting room with your students while you are not there to control it or manage the situation, right? Which means anything could be happening at that point. I don't think we want to open ourselves up to that risk or open our students up to that risk. And so I would recommend not checking this just because with the way things have evolved, unfortunately, it's now mandatory almost that you guys are in the room and with full control, just in case something like this happens to protect yourselves and your students. So again, I would not recommend this option. I think it opens up too big a security risk for us. Mute participants on entry. I do recommend this option. This hasn't changed. This is not a security thing. This is just a convenience and a smoothness thing. Same exact logic for the video up here. It's easier to have the microphones muted. That way, if somebody was to join late while you're in the lecture, you don't hear background noise of whatever is going on, the dog barking or, you know, whatever. For us today, it's the snowplow riding through the streets. Whatever it happens to be, even if that person doesn't mean to be distractive or disruptive, they may not even know their microphone's on, and it could still cause a problem. So for me, same logic as the video. Mute them, let them unmute themselves to speak when they are ready. Enable waiting room. This one's kind of a tricky one. So the waiting room, what it does is it creates a queue, essentially, a waiting room, so that instead of coming directly into the meeting, when you click on a link, you'll be directed into that waiting room. And then it's on the responsibility of the host to let people into the actual room. Pros and cons to this. I think this is a great tool to use for your virtual office hours, for your online office hours. Generally, those conversations are a little excuse me, a little bit more private and confidential. Maybe you're talking to a student about their grades. All these are things that we don't want any student just to be able to click on the link in Blackboard and come in and disrupt and interrupt those conversations. So the waiting room gives you a little bit more control on who can enter when, so that if you are sitting down and you are talking about grades with a student and someone else tries to join, another student tries to come in, instead of just coming in and seeing all those student A's grades, they're now in a waiting room. You can send them a message that says, hey, I'm with another student. Wait around 5 or 10 minutes and then I'll pull you into the room too. Things like that, right? Just gives you that control and ability to make the meeting space confidential and have the ability to decide who comes into the meeting rather than just everybody being let in blindly. With all that being said, and again, I think it's a great option for your virtual office hours. I'm not sure how great of an option it actually provides for our virtual classroom sessions with our students in the sense of like the large group meetings. And the reason for that is it depends, I think, a lot on how many students you have. If you only have, you know, 8, 10, 12 students, something like that, it might be easy for you to be like, okay, I recognize this student, let's bring them in. I recognize this student, let's bring them in. If you have 120, 140 students, it might be more difficult to look at that list and go, oh yeah, I recognize Jonathan. He's in my class. Let me pull him into the meeting. And so what I think you're going to end up doing a lot of time is admitting everybody anyway. And if there's a Zoom bomber in there, you're not going to realize it until they're already in. So as far as the security on the large classroom, I don't know how much of a role that this waiting room really plays, especially if you have a larger population. If it's one of the big lecture classes that has, you know, 100 plus students. The other downside is you have to constantly keep an eye on it, right? Because now if somebody joins late, they're not brought straight into your room. They can't just come in and listen to the lecture and try to pick up where they come in. They're waiting in the waiting room until you pull them in. And if you get caught up in the discussion, if you get caught up doing other things, you might even miss that they're there, right? And then they've spent the whole class, even though they tried to show up, in a waiting room instead of actually in the class listening to your presentations and your lectures. So I would caution, I don't want to say don't use it in your large classrooms, because if you can manage it, I think it is still a great tool. I just don't know. I think there is a lot of hype around this option for a security feature, and I don't know what, if I agree with the amount of security that it provides, only because, again, you have to know everybody who's coming in, right? And in a larger classroom, that gets much, much more difficult. In graduate classes, if you got 8, like I know one of my graduate classes with 8 people, 10 people, that might be more manageable to be like, okay, I recognize everybody here. I just, there's some classes where that's not going to work. So I'd say use this in a way that fits your class best. If you think it's good for your class, absolutely, we can put it on. I would caution against it in the large classrooms, but I think it's a great tool in the waiting rooms or in the office hours. Okay, only authenticated users can join. They want me to say this is an option you should check. I still don't think it is. I don't see the value that this brings to security. And I think it just makes life more difficult on your students to make it more difficult for them to sign in. I see what they're trying to do. However, this only allowed authenticated users is signed into Zoom. It's not anything specific to CSUSB, and anybody can create a Zoom account for free. So to me, this doesn't do a whole lot of a security, because if I wanted to get into a Zoom room that told me this, I could use a, you know, dummy email, make a free account right there and get in. It's not saying that they have to be logged into CSUSB. For that reason, I just don't see the value that it brings security wise, unless the people who are doing Zoom bombings just don't have an account and don't want to create an account to put their emails on there, right? In that sense, I guess it would provide you some security with that. It would also just though require that your students be logged into Zoom. We talked about how everybody has a Zoom account, students, faculty, and staff. However, they may not have gone through those steps we did in the beginning of this workshop to activate it. So if you're going to use this option to authenticate the users, and again, I think it can provide some security, though I don't see it as much as what everyone's saying, but this would prevent anybody who doesn't have a Zoom account from entering your classroom, which means if these Zoom bombers are going around and doing it just by the fact that they can enter any room, this would prevent that from happening. However, again, Zoom accounts are free, right? So anybody can create them at any point. If you do utilize this option, I would highly recommend you walk your students through, provide some sort of training tutorial information week one, the collaborate, right? Go to the My Coyote, click on collaborate, click on Zoom. That would make sure that their account is active and make sure that they have a working account, and would in my eyes at least, bypass a lot of the authentication and login issues you're going to run into if you select this option without doing that sort of tutorial, or at least information for your students. So again, I think this can be useful, but it does also impede us a little bit. So we need to make sure that we empower our students with the right information, the right tutorials to be able to successfully do that if that's an option we want to use. All right, record the meeting automatically. Any Zoom meeting can be recorded. It can only be recorded by the host. The participants cannot record unless the host specifically grants that participant permission. Right, so there are a lot of things that only the host can do by default. These are things like share your screen or annotate or, you know, things like that. And all of those things can be turned off or turned on globally. The recording cannot. You cannot, there is nothing that says all participants can record. If you want participants to record, you have to single-handedly, uniquely, and individually give them permission to do so, right? So if you have a class of 100 and you want to allow all 100 people to record, you have to give all 100 people the ability to do that one at a time, right? There's no global setting for that. When you are recording a meeting as the host, you will always get two choices. Do you want to record locally on your computer, or do you want to record on the cloud? And you can see those two choices here on the screen. The way I answer that question is to ask yourself, do you want to share this recording? Do you want this video that we're going to create to go to anybody else? Maybe your students for a resource, maybe one of your other peers, your faculties in the department, so you can they can see how you're doing your classes. Whatever it is, if we want to share this video, if we want other people to see the video, I would highly recommend we record in the cloud. What that is going to do is when the recording is over, finalized, and you've closed the meeting, Zoom is going to take a little bit and they're going to process and convert that video file. Once they've completed that, they'll send you an email with a share link. If you send that share link to anybody, post it in Blackboard, send it in an email, whatever it is, anybody who clicks on that share link will see your video recording. It'll already be up there. It'll be ready to go. If you record locally on the computer and then you decide later, you know what, I really want to share this. There was a really good engagement. We had good discussion. I think other students can benefit from this. Not a problem. We can absolutely put that up as well. It just takes a few more steps, right? So if you save locally on the computer, Zoom is going to save an MP4 file on your machine. We would then have to take that MP4 file, upload it to something like YouTube, mark it as unlisted so that nobody can find it, and then post it into your Blackboard. A lot more steps, but we can do it. It's just if you know ahead of time, I'm going to share this video with somebody, it's going to make your life a lot easier, and honestly mine, if you just click on the cloud and we do it that way. When we save on the cloud, all the recordings will be saved up here on our left-hand side panel under the recordings tab, right? So they will also send you an email, but if you lose the email or whatever, all of your recordings will be stored here. There currently is no policy for a rollover date as far as recordings. You get to keep the recordings at this point for forever. I would expect that to change very quickly. I think a lot of people are going to be using Zoom in the spring 2020 quarter, and our space is going to be limited much quicker than what we anticipated. So I would expect to see some sort of policy coming out saying you can only keep your recordings for one quarter or, you know, something like that. But at the moment, that's not in place. So the recordings that you have should always be here until further notice. All right. So that's the recordings. Again, if we have my thing, you will have the button inside the meeting if you don't use the record automatically feature. But again, either way is going to give you those options to do it on the cloud or to do it on the local computer. When you're done and we've set all of these things up, right? We've gone through and we've checked the things that we want to check. You just need to hit save. I'm going to hit cancel because again, I've kind of been going back and forth and this one, I already have this meeting kind of set up already. But you guys would need to hit save in order to finalize that. Once you do that, you should see the meeting populate on your upcoming meetings page. So you'll be taken back out to your Zoom webpage, you'll be on the meetings page, and you can see the virtual office hours meeting right there. It's exactly where it would show up when we go through that process and hit save. And now, if we wanted to allow people to join this meeting, right? Now we've set up the virtual office hours, how do we get our students into there? Well, the easiest way is just to provide this join URL for them right here. This HTTPS, that link, if they click on that link or paste it into their web browser, they'll be taken straight into the meeting. So you can either send this to them via email, via an announcement, or what I've been recommending is from your Blackboard page, we can use the plus sign up in the top left-hand corner to create a web link. right? This for the virtual office hours, we would create a web link. Anytime you create the Zoom meeting on the Zoom web page, we need to use a web link to populate it, right? So I'm going to call this, I clicked again, plus sign, web link, and then I'm going to call this virtual office hours. And I'm going to paste that join URL right into the URL box, right? So this URL box is just this join URL that I copied right here and pasted. I guess I didn't copy it because that's the message I sent you guys. Let me try that again. There the box, just the join URL, hopefully. Yes, okay. So that's the join URL. We paste that over there, make it available to our users, and hit submit. And then what you'll see pops up is a link for virtual office hours at the bottom. Now, when my students click on that link, they'll be taken directly into my Zoom meeting and we can do virtual office hours. All right, so it's just a quick way to put it on the left-hand side panel, give your students access to it whenever. Your students can access it through Blackboard, and you can too, although I would recommend against that very heavily. If we set up the meeting on Zoom webpage, I would highly recommend logging into the Zoom webpage in order to start that meeting, right? So if we go to my meetings tab here, we have the virtual office hours meeting. I've created that link over here. Both of these things will send me to the same exact location. The big difference is if we click on it from here, we may not be recognized as the host of the meeting, which means we would enter the meeting without any control, without any ability to do anything and really manage the situation. If we log in from the Zoom page by using that Collaborate My Coyote and making sure when we're on this profile page that this is our CSUSB account, as long as we access it from here, we are guaranteed to be logged into Zoom. And the value is that you are guaranteed to get host privileges and access and the ability to control your room. The worst thing that can happen is if we get into a room with our students and we are a student as well, now if one of those Zoom bombings takes place, we have absolutely no control, right? There's nothing we can do. We're just sitting there just like your students are. Having host is critical. And the easiest way, the easiest way to ensure that you have host is to just log into the Zoom and access your meetings this way by starting them on the right-hand side. That changes a little when we talk about the tool link in Blackboard, and we're going to jump into that right now. But you know, if you're having trouble authenticating, if you're having trouble and you keep trying to log into your Zoom room and they're saying you're not the host, or it's saying it's waiting for the host to still join, come back to your Zoom page, do it from your Zoom webpage, and it should fix that problem. All right. So now we've got our virtual office hours set up. Let's talk about how we can set up our classroom sessions for our students. Remember, I told you we're going to do that a little differently. There's kind of two steps to this process. This one, we're going to use that same plus sign, right? Remember, this plus sign is just a way for us to control the left-hand navigation panel. So all of the things in this plus sign pertain to everything in this little panel right here. And so because this is where I want to put a link to my classroom discussion for the Zoom room, I'm going to do plus sign. And the last one we did was web link. This one we're going to do is tool link. By clicking and creating this tool link, Blackboard is going to create a Zoom meeting for us on the back end of Zoom. It's going to do everything. It's going to create it all for us. We can only create that meeting once, right? So each individual Blackboard shell has one Zoom meeting that can be assigned to it using the tool link. If you delete the tool link from your Blackboard page, we can use the tool link again to bring that meeting back. However, if we delete the meeting from your Zoom page, there is no bringing that meeting back. So if that meeting is deleted from your Zoom page, it's gone. We have to wait till next quarter to use the tool link feature. In the meantime, we'll have to use a web link feature just like we did with the virtual office hours. There is no downside for your students as far as access. They would continue to click on it the same way. You would just lose the ability of having that built-in security of only having people from your Blackboard roster. You would also lose the ability to auto-log in as host if trying to access it from Blackboard as opposed to the Zoom webpage. Just some things to keep in mind. But okay, plus sign, tool link, and then we would name this whatever makes sense, right? We want it to be distinctly different than our virtual office hours so that our students know when they should use each link. But whatever makes sense for you, virtual classroom or online lecture, I'm going to just use Zoom meeting because it makes it easy for me. But this can be kind of whatever makes sense to you and your students. Then under the type, instead of achievements, we're going to click on this drop-down box. This brings up every tool that we have access to in Blackboard. The one that we want is at the bottom, Zoom meeting. right? So again, we went plus sign tool link, we gave it a name, and then we changed the type from achievements down to Zoom meeting. Then we just need to make it available to our users and hit submit. And there it is. Now we've created a room. Now, I know what you're thinking, you know, Jonathan, we just spent 15, 20 minutes going through all these meeting settings and creation and, you know, host video on and off, enable waiting room. We didn't do any of that with this one. What happened? Well, Zoom is, or Blackboard's going to create this Zoom meeting for you using your defaults, right? So when we come back to our Zoom webpage, there's a settings tab here. Zoom is going to use everything on this settings tab to create the settings for that meeting. And there's a lot, right? It's a bunch of settings. I'll be 100% honest with you. Every time I do these workshops and I work with faculty, I'm finding new stuff that we can do in these settings. There's just a lot to it. I wouldn't recommend necessarily poking through all this unless there's something Zoom isn't doing for you that you're like, you know what? I really think it should. It's probably buried in here somewhere. But this is the settings that Blackboard's going to use. So we could update all of these and then Blackboard would create the meeting fine. However, that's a lot of work, right? There's a bunch of stuff in here and I don't want to make you have to go through all that or try to understand what all of that is. So instead what we can do is if we click on the meeting and it is imperative that you click on it, I would say once you create this tool link, click on it and open it immediately, right? I'm still working on some stuff. We had an incident where somehow a student became host of a Zoom room, and I'm still trying to troubleshoot to figure out how that happened. My only guess right now is that maybe the faculty didn't start it, so Blackboard went as the first person to join it. I'm not 100% sure. I don't want to get into it now because it is a lot of me just thinking about stuff and trying to test things out, but it's imperative. When you click on that tool link, right, we go plus sign tool link, we create it all, click on the meeting, get into it, open it up, and start it. That's going to do two things. One, it should solidify you as the host of that meeting, right? Because now you've opened it and it's started. The second thing it's going to do is it's that opening process that's going to allow Blackboard to populate our Zoom page with that meeting, right? So just creating the tool link won't populate our Zoom webpage. We have to click on and open the meeting in order for that Blackboard meeting to appear on this page, right? I can't do that now because we are in a Zoom meeting. So if I did, I would be kicked out and you guys would lose the facilitator for this workshop. So I can't do that, but it is really, really important that you guys do. So when you create that, click on it, open it. Opening it is going to make it show up on either this page here, your upcoming meetings, or possibly your previous meetings page. It may populate here as well. But it should be on one of these. And why that's important is once it exists on the Zoom webpage, for example, if I go to my next page here, this Brooks Sandbox 2 was one of mine from the other ones. I can click on that meeting and edit it just like I can anything else, right? So when we're talking about settings, we didn't set any of them up by using the tool link. But when we open it, we can go back to Zoom, open that meeting and edit it just like any other meeting, right? At that point, maybe you want to make it a recurring meeting with no fixed time so that it's always gonna be on your upcoming meetings instead of your previous meetings page. That would be the time to do that. Take off the waiting room if you don't wanna use that, or you know, just make sure that our settings are set the way we want them. And that when we meet with our students, it's gonna go as smoothly as we want it to. All right. I'm a little bit behind for sure, so we're going to have to move quick here. But at this point, we've talked about how to activate your account. We have talked about how to set up a Zoom meeting in Zoom itself, the web page. We've also talked about how to set it up in Blackboard. And I just, for clarification, I want to go over. So what I would say is once you create the tool link, right? So you come to your Blackboard course, you go plus sign tool link, just like we did, and it's set up right here. You don't have to create the meeting first, right? Blackboard's going to create it for you. So it's not something you have to set up ahead of time. Your first steps for setting up your classroom discussion can be in Blackboard. And then just plus sign tool link, get it all up there. But then click on this link and then click on the blue join meeting button, right? Actually open it up. Get into the Zoom interface like we are now so you can see the toolbar and everything. You don't have to spend a tremendous amount of time there. You don't have to spend more than a second in there. But I want you guys to have that room open, because that's going to be that process that's going to make it so when we're on our My Meetings tab, so you can see it here. I didn't even have to open it all the way. This is that meeting tool link that we just set up. Grade Center Workshop. If I come back over here and back, you can see that's the name of my Blackboard course is Grade Center Workshop. And that's the meeting that popped up. So just by clicking on it to get to the, I still would recommend you get into the interface, right? Open up Zoom just to make sure, because that's going to really secure you as the host to, and avoid any issues there. But then once it's here, we can come back and make any edits that we want. Require a meeting password or mute participants on entry or anything like that, right? So that's the big thing. All right, and then just remember again, the difference between the tool link and the web link, the main thing is that the tool link is going to be restricted to just your Blackboard students. We've even seen issues, I can't even log in unless I'm enrolled into your student as an admin. I've seen TAs in your class not get access for some reason. So it is a very restrictive group, and we're still trying to figure out exactly what the requirements and parameters of each thing are. But that's the biggest difference, is when you click on that, you get brought in instantly as the host. It's using your role in Blackboard as your authentication. Excuse me. Okay. All right, we gotta move. By default, Zoom does not share Zoom windows. What that means is you guys can see my screen. You can see kind of everything that's going on in there, with the exception of if I drag over the participants window. You guys probably don't see a participants window on there now. If I drag over the chat, you guys can't see the chat. And most importantly, and the question I've been getting most often is, if I drag over these video profiles, right, where I see all of our lovely faces, you guys don't see the videos on your screen, right? So what's important to note is, just because you have the video up on your screen does not necessarily mean that that's what the students see. The view of the video and really all Zoom windows, chat, participant, all those sort of things, is user dependent. So it's dependent on what the user has set up. Now, obviously, this is different if we're talking about a recording. The recording is going to record whatever's going on your screen. So wherever you have the video, that's what's going to be recorded. But as far as the user interface, I've heard some express concerns from faculty who are like, well, I'm giving my PowerPoint and I have my picture's not there. Can the students still see my picture? As long as they have their window open, yes, they can still see your picture. And just, shouldn't, because I said I wanted to move quickly, but just... I was smart enough to close my mouth that time. So this window here is the video window. This is the one that is customizable for everybody, right? So you guys may not have it set up in this tiered way that I do, but just very quickly, this option here minimizes it entirely. You will not see a video if the student has that option selected. It'll just be a little bar and it'll say talking in somebody's name, just giving you an indication of who's talking. This video button right next to it is a single window. So it shows a single window that will generally highlight whoever's talking, or if we spotlight something or something like that, but it's only gonna be one video at a time is the central part of that. And generally whoever's talking will become that video. Always important to note, if there's only two people, it's always just gonna show you the other person, right? But in larger classes, that shouldn't be an issue. You shouldn't have to worry about that. The other option here is the option we are using in this screenshot that you see. And it shows me everybody's video within, you know, certain, numbers. Obviously there are restrictions to it, but because we only have a few people here, I get to see everybody's video. And all while I have everything else up, right? But again, it's based on their user setup. It's not something that you can necessarily change for them. They have to kind of do it on their own. All right. All of that to say, Zoom doesn't share the windows of Zoom, and that's primarily designed to make it cleaner, right? If you're sharing your PowerPoint and somebody chats you, you don't want that chat popping up for everybody else. It can be distracting. It's probably distracting for you, but you don't want distracting for your students either, which is great. I think that's an awesome tool, and there is ways to change it in the settings. However, what that means is my job becomes a little bit more difficult, because it makes it difficult to tutorial on Zoom when I can't share Zoom windows. For that reason, I have taken pictures. A few things to note about these pictures. What you are seeing is, as of now, the most up-to-date picture, but Zoom's constantly changing stuff. They're updating every day. They're fighting this security issue, probably more so than we are, because they're the actual company, but they're constantly trying to make changes and improvements, so this may change, but this is what it is now. The other thing to note is you may not see everything as we go through it, because you are not the host of the meeting, right? As the host, I get access to certain things. So like the breakout rooms button over here, if you look now, you will not see that breakout rooms button. It is not because your Zoom is broken, it is just because I'm the host of this meeting and you guys are the participants. All right, with that, let's start powering through this. mute and video. These are the two control buttons on the left-hand side. They basically are the start and stop toggle buttons for your camera and for your microphone. If you see the red line through it, like it is my video, that means that you would not be able, that nobody else would be able to see your video. Your video is off. If there is no red line through it, like in the case of the microphone, that means it is on and people can either see you and or hear you, whichever option. The microphone will even have a little thing where it starts filling up with a, I think it's green, sometimes it's gray, but it'll start kind of bouncing. And that's just letting you know you've connected your microphone correctly. It's picking up audio, and everybody should be able to hear you. And if they can't, it's likely something on their end because Zoom is reading your microphone, no problem. The only other thing I'd like to point out about these particular options is this little upward arrow. In this instance over here, and actually in most instances where the upward arrow is there, think of that like an advanced settings or advanced options. This is where you would need to go if you had multiple devices. So say you have two cameras connected to your machine or two microphones or two speakers. These upward arrows is where you would need to go to tell Zoom which one of those two options you want to use. If you're using a phone, a tablet, the laptop, you know, most of those come with the built-in stuff, and Zoom's gonna, if there's only one, Zoom will grab the right one every time. It's when there's multiple devices that you may have to access these upward arrows to do a little bit of selection as far as devices. With the video, that's where you also get the option to do virtual backgrounds. I would caution you against the virtual backgrounds. Use it, but play with it first because they're not the best. If you can see my video, you now saw me transported from my old kitchen into the beach. You can do it. However, it depends a lot on the requirements of your computer. So I have heard from faculty that they're getting a message saying that they don't have the requirements for it. As well as, if you can tell, it's not super great. It's based a lot off the lighting, right? So test it, play with it. But if your lighting's bad, it's going to be more of a distraction and a hindrance than a cool feature that you can use. So if that's something you want to do, I would suggest playing around with it, but do it cautiously. I've seen it used in times where it ends up distracting. You start watching to see how many times their ear cuts out or something instead of actually paying attention to what's happening. But yeah, that's where that one would be. Okay, cool. This one's a new one. This is the newest feature that they added, and I think they added it a couple days ago. The security feature. I love it. Before, all of the permissions and the things were buried. They were hidden and they were all in their own separate areas. So if you wanted to stop somebody from sharing their screen, you had to click on what was a little advanced option here. You would turn off participant share screen. If you wanted to stop somebody from, let's say, annotating, right? Like I'm doing now in the thing, you would have to, while we're under the, while I'm under this annotation screen, I would have to click on more, go to disable participants annotation, right? You could do it. It was a feature that was always there, but it wasn't easy to get to unless you knew how to get there, and you had to know how to get to each and every one. They were all buried in their own location. This security tool takes that away. When you click on the security tool, this is what will pop up. It's a super quick and easy way to either lock the meeting, enable a waiting room, which to me are, okay, I guess that's all right. The big ones for me though is allow participants to share screen, chat, rename themselves, I care less about, but the share screen and the chat, it's your way of, if this Zoom bombing happens, if somebody gets into your room and they start sharing their screen, you know, whatever vulgar material they decide to share with all your students, you can click that quickly security button, turn off the share screen, and it exits it instantly, right? Super, super easy. If someone's in the chat and they're being disruptive in that sense and vulgar in that sense and harassing to your students, we can quickly turn off the chat. This is like your panic button, right? If something does happen, in a perfect world, we prepare you and we put you with the right settings that we never are put in that situation, right? But we don't live in a perfect world. So we have to be prepared for that. And this is the panic button. This is the, okay, worst case scenario just happened. A Zoom bombing is now in my room. This is where you're going to want to come to take care of it. I used to say the participants panel was the biggest panel because that's where it gave you a lot of the control. A lot of the control now lies here. And it's really important that you know where this option is. And what you may be thinking is, you know, well, that's not everything, right? Well, you know, maybe they're annotating. I'm sharing my screen. People are writing weird stuff. As soon as you start to share your screen, you will get another option on there that says annotate on shared content. And you can just uncheck that and make it so no students can annotate. I would probably recommend doing that anyway, unless there's something specific you want your students to annotate, to be able to draw and write. Even if you're not dealing with the Zoom bombings, just in normal workshops and things, it can get real distracting with this option on, even if people are just playing with it and trying it out. Unless there's a reason you want your students to be annotating, that might be one that you probably just want to uncheck just right off the bat. But unless there's a reason, unless you want your students to be able to use some spotlights to point out things or something like that. We're going to talk about the annotation in a lot more detail, hopefully quickly. I do need to move fast though. But security button, now my new favorite button. Familiarize yourself with it, click on it, play with it, know what it does and how to use it. It is really straightforward, simple, easy clicks. But this is the panic button, Matt. This is when something goes wrong, this is how we take control again, right? In a way that is a little bit more manageable than just like shutting the whole room down or something like that. Okay. Manage participants, still a really important panel. Still probably one of the top panels and one you really should be familiar with. When you click on manage participants, you're gonna see a panel like this. It's gonna show you everybody who's in your room. What I really love about this panel is this is like the heartbeat of my workshops and my courses. This is what lets me know what's going on. I can see everybody who's here. I can see the status of their video, the status of their microphone, whether or not they're recording, whether or not they're sharing their screen. It's what I call classroom management in the virtual world, right? It's where I'm allowed to mute people. If we have a classroom and there's that microphone that's disruptive in the background, I don't have to ask for somebody to mute it. I can quickly open up this panel, see where the audio is coming from, and by hovering their name, I'll have an option to mute, and I can just shut that microphone down. You can hover anybody's name, and two buttons will appear right here. One of them says mute, the other one says more. And under more, you can do any host of things like ask them to rename themselves, rename them yourself, ask them to turn their camera on, unmute them, turn their microphone on. One thing is with Zoom, you can always control the microphones. You cannot control the videos as far as turning them on. You can turn them off. So right now I could turn all of your videos off if I wanted to. I cannot turn them back on, however, and that's just a privacy thing, right? Like, you can't be turning on other people's cameras, especially if they don't want to be on camera. So that's one thing to know. But you can remove them from the meeting. You can rename them. You can mute them. You can ask them to start their video. The participant panel really gives you a lot of control. And again, a lot of that's moved to the security tab now, which is great. But the participants panel is still really important as far as the smaller management tools. And the security would be more of like the, oh no button. We need to take control very quickly. One of my favorite things about the participants panel is the mute all button. And that sounds rude, but if you have a large classroom, if you've got 80, if you've got 100 students, it may be tough to find that mic that's making noise. Right now, scrolling through two or three people, I could probably pick it out pretty quickly, but that obviously changes when you have a lot more people. And rather than try to sift through 120 names to find where the bouncing microphone is, it might be better to just mute all and turn them all down. When you do, you will be given this box. What's important about this box is there's an option to allow participants to unmute themselves. By default, this is checked, right? So by default, participants can unmute themselves even after you mute them. And that's generally a courtesy I like to extend to my audience, right? You may have noticed I've muted you all in this workshop, but you are encouraged to unmute yourself asking questions. It's just to avoid any background noise, anything like that. However, if you uncheck that, the participants would not be able to unmute themselves, and the responsibility would be solely on you to unmute them when they want to speak. And they can get your attention through a number of different ways, maybe in the chat, or perhaps under the participants panel, there's a raise hand button. They can click on that and get your attention. You can unmute them that way. Just do keep in mind, if you take away the ability for students to unmute themselves, you will have to be the one to do it if you want them to engage verbally. The other thing about the participants panel is there's a more button at the bottom. A lot of these things, they kind of changed and moved to the security tab, so we don't need to worry about it too much, but it is just a quick way to kind of change some of the settings on the fly without having to go back to the Zoom webpage. So like, for example, mute participants on entry. If we know we wanted to do mute participants on entry, but we forgot to set it up in the settings, we can change it right quick, real here. We can change it really quick right here, and it will go through and it'll be fine. What's important to note, it'll only be for this instance of the meeting. Once you close the meeting and restart it, it will go back to whatever the meeting on that the meeting settings pages, right? So whatever we're doing here is just, it's closing it for this instance of the meeting, not all of them. And then also the ability to lock the meeting. Think of this like locking your doors to your classroom. It makes it so that nobody who isn't already in the meeting can get in at all. The thing I would caution you about here is it would impact the student if maybe they were in your meeting and then they got kicked out or had an internet issue. If you had the meeting locked, they'd be unable to get back in when they tried to rejoin, right? So I would say use that one cautiously. It is being pushed as a good security tool, though I think this is one of the ones that kind of has a hard time distinguishing between the harassing people and our students who were trying to get in. So I would use that one cautiously. But participants tool is still really big. It's not the biggest one anymore. That's now the security button. That's the new number one. But participants panel is still really important. Okay, chat. We've been using that in this workshop here today. It's just a text chat. So if somebody doesn't have a microphone or maybe doesn't feel comfortable speaking verbally, they can communicate via the chat. By default, the chat is set up with two different ways. It can either be to everybody, right? Which means when you send stuff, it looks like all the messages that we've sent in this chat have been to everybody. So everybody in the room saw them. You could also send private messages to only an individual. So I could send a private message to Harold or to Anna and nobody else would see that except for me and them. What's important to note about the private messaging is you have the ability to turn it off and just have it as general messaging, the everyone type stuff. But if you have it turned on, private messaging is left as on, we have no control over that. We have no ability to monitor that. Any private messaging that gets sent between students is between those students. And there's nothing we can do to retrieve those records or anything like that. So I just want to point that out and make sure that we mention that in regards to the chat. All right, share screen. This one's a big one still, right? Probably the top three, participant, security, share screen. Share screen is how you're gonna do exactly what we're doing now. Allow you to share your content with your students, whether that's a PowerPoint presentation, a PDF article, or maybe a YouTube video, whatever it is, if we're sharing it from our screen, the big share screen button is how we're going to do it. It used to be that by default, anybody could share screen. And then at one point it was changed to host only. Now I'm not 100% sure. You'd probably have to check that security button to see what it says. I think it is still that by default, only the host can share their screen and the participants cannot unless you change it on that security button, right? So that would be coming to here and making sure that share screen is checked if you want your students to share. If you do not, then unchecking it would make it so only the host can share their screen. When you click on share screen, here we go. This is the page you will see. It's a little window that will pop up. These options on the top are going to be consistent every single time you open it, right? You will always have the option for whiteboard. You will always have the option for iPhone, iPad, and your screens will always be there. It's just depending on how many screens you have connected to your computer. So if you have two screens hooked up like I do, you will see screen one and screen two. If you have 10 screens hooked up, you will screen one, two, three, four, all the way through 10, right? So this number is dependent on the number of monitors that you have connected to your computer. Every window below that, when you clicked on the share screen button, the green button for Zoom took a snapshot of every window that you have open on your PC, every window that you have open on your computer. And what these bottom options do is share only that window. Right? So in an example, let's say this is my PowerPoint. If this is my PowerPoint and this is the option that I selected when I was sharing with my students, they would be able to see my PowerPoint window. But if I minimize that window or if I opened up another document, like a Word document, they wouldn't see any of that. The upside to this is you limit what your students can see, right? So it doesn't give them full access to seeing everything that's open on your computer. The downside to this, and the reason why I don't utilize it, is I often forget what I've shared or what they can see. In this example specifically, let's say this was a PowerPoint. Maybe I have a YouTube video on my PowerPoint. If I'm going through my PowerPoint slides, my students are with me, they see everything. When I click on that YouTube video, a web browser opens up. Now my students don't see that. I have to go to new share and I have to bring them over and make sure that they're seeing what's in the YouTube video. Whereas if I just select one of these screens, they see everything on my screen as I see it, right? So in this workshop here, you may have noticed I'm bouncing back and forth. I've got a couple images set up. I've got a web page set up. We've got a couple different things, different windows that we're moving between. At no point have you guys seen a lag or anything. You guys see everything as I go through it. If I were to just minimize everything, you guys would see my desktop, right? The reason why I prefer this and using these screen options is I don't have to think about it. I don't need to worry about what can my students see. I just need to give my presentation like I would. It helps tremendously to have two monitors because I can leave everything that I want to present on this right side monitor and leave all of my Zoom stuff like my chat box and all of those other things and the images on the left side monitor and not get them mixed up. But I would usually highly recommend using the screen option because it just takes away the guesswork. There have been too many times giving a workshop when I use these other options that I would click on a new window and 2 minutes would go by before one of my participants would chime in and say, oh, hey, yeah, we can't see anything you're doing. And then I'm starting over and I'm getting lost. For me, these top options make it so I don't have to think about it. The one thing I would caution you about these top options is they do allow your students to see everything you see as you see it, right? So if you have some personal or private information, some information that's not appropriate for your students, you want to get rid of that stuff before we start sharing your screen, right? This could be banking information, or maybe it's grades, or whatever it happens to be. If there's something that isn't meant for your students' eyes, let's get rid of it first, and then start doing the share screen, and then use the screen options that way we're not worried about it. The whiteboard is exactly what it sounds like. It's a blank white space that you or your participants can write on. You can also cycle through and create as many pages of the whiteboard as you want. With both the whiteboard and really anything that you share, you have the ability to annotate. This is the box of the annotation options that both you and your participants will have at their disposal. Obviously, we can cancel this by going into that security tab and turning off the participant annotation and just allowing for host to annotate. But yeah, it's a pretty cool tool. I would say it is a much better tool if you have something like a iPad and a stylus, right? Because then you can actually write stuff. If you've seen any of my arrows in terrible doodles during this workshop, doing it with a mouse is very difficult, at least for me. And so if you have a stylus, I think this is a pretty cool tool. If not, I'm sorry. The one other thing I want to mention about annotation is that you are not actually marking the document, right? So you can see me, I can write on this picture that I have here, but I'm not actually marking that picture. And if I change to a web page, you notice that that annotation came with me, right? And when I scroll, it moves with me as well. Think of what you're doing with the annotation as an overlay, like you're writing over the top of something. You can save it as an image if you'd like, but it is not actually editing that image at all. All right. Clear that out. And just briefly, before we move on from the share window, if you are going to share video with your students, whether this is through YouTube or whatever it is, if you are sharing video, you absolutely must select, you must select those two options at the bottom. You have to check share computer sound. You have to check optimize for full screen video. They are not selected by default, but if you are going to do video, it is imperative that you click on those two buttons. Otherwise, your students will not experience the video. They will either not hear it correctly or they will not see it correctly. Both of these options need to be checked if you're sharing video. All right. What else we got here? All right, let's quickly, because I'm already 10 minutes over, but these last buttons are kind of easy ones anyway. Record, we already talked about recordings. Again, if you have it set up to automatically record in the meeting, this button will not appear here. It'll say something like pause recording or stop recording because the recording's already going because it started automatically. Again, either option, whether you do it on the settings before, whether you do it in here, you will be given cloud or local computer. If you're going to share the recording, you want to do it on the cloud. Otherwise it can obviously be on the local computer if it's just for your own records. Closed caption button doesn't do anything, unfortunately, at the moment. The way this closed captioning button works is you can either assign a student to do all of the captioning, meaning they type everything that they hear in the meeting. You can do it yourself if you think you're up to doing that while leading and facilitating a discussion and lecture. Or the third option is they recently started doing work with AST, Automatic Sync Technologies, which is a pay for caption service. So for a price, they will caption your videos for you. However, it is just that, it's a pay for caption service. I would say at the moment, this kind of button doesn't really do a tremendous amount, but I am hopeful that maybe at some point we can get a campus license worked out where that's all taken care of for us. In the meantime, I would recommend if you need some captioning issue or captioning assistance, talking to either SSD, Services for Students with Disabilities, and or our accessibility team headed by Christine Fundell. They should be able to help you out with any accessibility or captioning needs should you have a student with disabilities in your course. But unfortunately, this button right now, not very useful. All right, breakout rooms. This is the last big button. Last one we're going to go into a little bit of actual content with. Breakout rooms is virtual group rooms, or virtual group work, right? So if we were all in a face-to-face class, you could break people out into groups. They could all collaborate. It would work pretty smoothly. In a virtual environment like Zoom, if you have 20 people in the same room and you tried to have them all talk simultaneously, you're not going to hear a word that's said, right? So it's going to be chaos and noise. Breakout rooms give us the ability to manage that group space in a way that's a little bit easier. So essentially what happens is when you click on the breakout rooms button, you'll be seeing a screen like this. Zoom is going to look at how many participants you currently have in your meeting. Now, when I did the screenshot, it was zero because I was just doing screenshots. However many participants you have would be here. And then how many rooms do you want to divide them into? And then obviously Zoom is going to do its best job to equally assign, membership into those rooms. You can either have that membership assigned automatically by Zoom, which means Zoom will randomly assign students into specific breakout rooms, or you could do it manually yourself, which means you would be in charge of assigning who's in each group and who's going into each room. Once you've done all of that, you hit create rooms, and you'll see a screen like this with all of your students into the specific breakout rooms that they were assigned to. You can either move them around, exchange them, right? Make changes to the membership, or open all the rooms. What this is going to do is it's going to send them into a Zoom room where they have much the functionality of what we have in a normal Zoom room. They'll be able to share their screens with each other. They'll be able to chat. They'll be able to talk and see each other visually with the cameras. They also will get an option at the bottom that says ask for help. And when they click on the ask for help button, you as the host will get a message that says, hey, students in room 3 need some help. And you can jump straight into that room and talk to them. What's important to note is you by default will remain in the main room. All right. So all the students will go into, in this case, our 4 breakout rooms. You will remain in the main room. And when you are in that main room, you cannot communicate with your students verbally or visually, meaning they cannot hear you and they cannot see you. You can send them a text message. I think Zoom calls it a banner, a chat banner or something, that would go to all the groups. Say something like, we're going to be wrapping up in 10 minutes. Make sure you cover this specific key point, something like that. But you cannot actually speak to them unless you jump into the breakout room specifically that they're in. As the host, you can enter and leave any room that you see as you see fit. I would also just take a look at this options page. Not make or break stuff, but minor inconvenience things like there by default, there's a 60-second timer on closing breakout rooms. That bothered me. When I want to close my breakout rooms, I want them closed now, not a minute from now. You know, time's of the essence. So just check it out. It's not going to change the way it functions from a core perspective, but it might change out how you feel about using it. And quality of life options, I guess, is what I would call these ones here. But yeah, so you can get them all in there. They can all share, collaborate, group work, and then you can bring them all back into your room and have them share out what they worked on. The only thing I will mention about the breakout rooms is it is not connected to Blackboard in the sense of like groups or something like that. It's also something that you have to set up in the moment, right? It has to be a just-in-time thing because it is going to look at your current participants to set room membership. So it's not something you can do ahead of time. And unfortunately, if you want to utilize the same groups kind of moving forward every week, you would have to set those up manually. There's no way to set that up to where it's automatically going to make the same groups each time you join. It's going to be on you to manually assign the membership for that when you want to use them. Okay. Last couple things. End meeting. This used to be a different type of conversation. Now, what I'm going to say is when you click that button, you probably want to end it for all. There's two options. You can leave the meeting or you can end it for all. If you leave the meeting, it leaves everybody in the meeting to still communicate, still have discussions. And I think that that's a dangerous prospect in today's world for the same reason that we don't want to allow them to join before we get there, right? If we leave the meeting, we leave a room open, we are leaving the possibility for somebody to get in with our students in a room that they have no control over and there is no one to control it. So while there might be some instances where leaving the meeting would be beneficial to your students as far as the communication and exchange of ideas, things like that, for security reasons, it might be best just to end the meeting for all, close the meeting down, and make sure that nobody can be in there interacting with your students without us having some say in that. Okay, with that is everything I wanted to talk about Zoom-wise. Quick things that I want to say other than that is ATI webpage, there is a page that we are building called instructional continuity. On the ATI main webpage, there's access to this instructional continuity. We've also broken up a few other things here, like access to our past workshop recordings, appointments with instructional designers. So if you want to meet with a designer for 30 minutes or an hour, whatever it is, through Zoom, you can set that up using Calendly. But the instructional continuity page, I think it's a great resource. It's got a lot of handouts and we're constantly trying to add things to them as we see them pop up. But it's a great place to look if you're like, man, I remember Jonathan talking about this, but I don't remember exactly what it is. It's probably listed here. Take a look, see if you can find it. And not just for Zoom. There's plenty of other stuff here, like how do you do tests, creating assessments in Blackboard, right? It's a great resource. And I think a place to at least start looking for the answers. And then if you can't find it, well, at least you're in the right spot to make an appointment with one of us, right? So I just think it's a great tool and I've been trying to direct faculty in that general direction. With that, we are done. If you have no other questions, I wanna thank you all for coming out. As is tradition with my workshops, I am gonna stick around for about another 30 minutes to an hour or so, whatever it takes to answer any questions you may have specific for me. But yeah, if you don't have anything else, thank you guys for coming and have a wonderful day.
You too. Thank you.
Thank you. Did you guys have any questions or?
I don't.
All right. How about you, Anna? I think you're muted. I muted you. But you should be able to unmute yourself. Remember that microphone in the bottom lower corner, and let me make life even.
There we go. Sorry.
There you go.
Thank you. No. You got them all already. Thank you so much. I appreciate your time.
All right. Awesome. Well, thank you guys. If you have any other questions, they should be sending out a workshop. I know we are cutting down on the workshops next week, just to try to help some of the faculty get ready for classes. Our faculty consultation meetings are increasing quite heavily. So I know we are going to cut down a little on the workshops, but I think we are still giving them. So you guys should see that schedule coming out soon. If you have any other questions, then obviously I check out the webpage to set something up with us.
Okay. Very good. Thanks again.
Bye-bye. Thank you guys. Have a great day.
You too.
Bye.
Care.
You too. Bye.